On a cold December day in 2000, the tranquility of this picturesque setting was shattered by a grim discovery. Three friends casting their lines stumbled upon a chilling sight, a body floating near the shore. What they initially mistook for a log turned out to be a man, his hands bound and a noose tightly wound around his neck. It was evident that this was no accident. The man had been murdered. The victim, later identified as Dariusz Janiszewski, a businessman from Wroclaw, had been reported missing weeks earlier. His body bore signs of torture, and forensic analysis revealed he had been starved before his death. Despite an extensive investigation, the case remained unsolved, earning it the moniker of the perfect crime. Years later, Detective Jacek Wroblewski reopened the case, determined to unravel the mystery. Despite the challenges posed by the cold trail, Wroblewski's relentless pursuit of justice led him to delve deeper into the files, searching for overlooked clues that could crack the case wide open. As Wroblewski combed through the evidence, he uncovered disturbing details hinting at a motive rooted in personal vendetta rather than robbery. The brutality of the crime and the absence of any financial motive raised questions about the perpetrator's identity and their connection to the victim. Detective Wroblewski meticulously reviewed the statements provided to the local police, seeking any clue that could shed light on Janiszewski's disappearance. The most intriguing account came from Janiszewski's mother, who recounted a peculiar phone call received at her son's advertising firm on the day he vanished. A mysterious caller, described as sounding professional, had made a strange request for three large signs, insisting on speaking directly with Janiszewski. Despite the caller's refusal to disclose further details, Janiszewski's mother passed on his cell phone number. Later, when Janiszewski returned to the office, he mentioned arranging to meet the caller that afternoon. Further investigation revealed that the call to Janiszewski's office originated from a nearby phone booth, suggesting a deliberate attempt to conceal the caller's identity. Suspiciously, moments later, a call was placed to Janiszewski's cell phone from the same public phone. Although these calls raised suspicion, Wroblewski could not definitively tie them to the perpetrator. Considering Janiszewski's stature, it seemed unlikely that he could have been overpowered and disposed of by a single assailant. Witnesses reported seeing two men trailing Janiszewski, indicating the involvement of accomplices. Wroblewski marveled at the perpetrator's meticulous planning and execution of the crime. Despite his efforts to uncover additional leads, Wroblewski found himself at a dead end. Yet, the mystery deepened when he realized that Janiszewski's cell phone had never been recovered. In a surprising turn, the phone's serial number led Wroblewski to an internet auction site, where it had been sold under the username Chris B. The seller, identified as Krystian Bala, raised suspicion. However, it seemed implausible that someone capable of orchestrating such a sophisticated crime would carelessly sell the victim's phone online. Intriguingly, Bala was also an author, having recently published a novel titled Amok, noted for its dark and disturbing themes. As Wroblewski delved deeper into Bala's background, the lines between fiction and reality blurred, raising unsettling questions about the author's potential involvement in Janiszewski's disappearance. Krystian Bala, a young entrepreneur featured in a documentary about Poland's burgeoning capitalist scene, seemed an unlikely businessman. With a passion for philosophy and an academic dream, Bala's life took a turn when he started an industrial cleaning business. Despite his intellect, Bala struggled with financial management and eventually faced bankruptcy. His personal life mirrored the chaos, with a failed marriage and a penchant for affairs. Amidst his struggles, Bala delved into writing his novel, Amok, a dark exploration of philosophical themes. The protagonist, Chris, embodies postmodern nihilism, rejecting conventional morality and truth. Through a series of violent and explicit acts, Chris challenges societal norms and revels in his own depravity. Krystian Bala completed his novel, Amok, in late 2002, drawing parallels between himself and the protagonist, Chris, blurring the lines between author and narrator. He even engaged with readers on his blog under the persona of Chris, adding to the enigma surrounding his identity. When questioned about the dark themes of the book, Bala cryptically hinted at the possibility that he himself was a creation of Chris. Despite generating some buzz online, Amok faced limited distribution in Poland due to its explicit content, with bookstores placing it out of reach or refusing to stock it altogether. While a few reviewers praised its raw realism and provocative nature, many readers and critics dismissed it as lacking literary merit. Bala defended his work, arguing that it aimed to challenge societal norms and expose the hypocrisy of the world. Detective Wroblewski meticulously analyzed passages from Amok as he delved deeper into the investigation. Although the murder depicted in the novel differed significantly from Janiszewski's case, certain details struck him as eerily similar, particularly the mention of selling a Japanese knife on an internet auction, akin to the selling of Janiszewski's cell phone, raised suspicions. This detail, undisclosed to the public, seemed too uncanny to dismiss as mere coincidence. Another chilling revelation surfaced in the novel when Chris hinted at having also killed a man. With Bala residing abroad, Wroblewski cautioned against alarming him, realizing that apprehending him would be challenging if he remained outside Poland. Instead, the team focused on gathering information from public records and interrogating Bala's acquaintances, comparing his profile with that of the character Chris in the novel. Striking similarities emerged. Both Bala and Chris were deeply immersed in philosophy, experienced marital troubles, faced financial setbacks, traveled extensively, and struggled with alcohol. Wroblewski's intuition grew stronger as he uncovered Bala's past encounter with law enforcement, finding a stark resemblance to Chris's narrative. Detective Wroblewski understood that details from the novel were not sufficient evidence and needed independent corroboration. Despite analyzing responses to a TV program seeking tips on Janiszewski's murder, no substantial leads emerged. However, a curious discovery was made regarding Bala's internet activity before the crime, indicating possible premeditation. Still, Wroblewski knew circumstantial evidence alone wouldn't secure a conviction. A confession was essential. While Bala remained abroad, he continued his life, seemingly unaware of the impending investigation. Upon his return, Bala was brought in for questioning, where Wroblewski subtly probed for information without revealing their suspicions. When confronted about the murder, Bala denied involvement and admitted to drawing inspiration for the book from his life, but denied any direct link to the crime. Despite this, the discovery of the cell phone remained a significant point of contention, with Bala claiming uncertainty about its origins and agreeing to a polygraph test. Bala responded negatively to each question during the polygraph test, occasionally exhibiting behavior reminiscent of a scuba diver, adjusting breathing patterns, raising suspicions of manipulation. While some answers appeared deceptive, the overall results were inconclusive. In Poland, suspects must be charged or released after 48 hours of detention. With insufficient evidence linking Bala to the murder, authorities charged him only with selling stolen property and bribery in an unrelated matter. These charges were unlikely to result in significant jail time, leaving Bala essentially free. Wroblewski felt his case collapsing after 2 years of investigation. Reviewing Bala's passport, Wroblewski noted stamps from countries where web views on the TV show 997 site originated. This correlation puzzled investigators, raising questions about international interest in a local Polish murder. As scrutiny over the investigation intensified, Bala garnered support and formed a defense committee. His girlfriend, Denise Reinhardt, spearheaded efforts, highlighting alleged mistreatment during interrogation and citing Bala's novel as a basis for persecution. Dubbed the Sprawa Absurd, the case attracted global attention, prompting letters to the Polish Justice Ministry advocating for Bala's rights. Despite Bala's distressing bulletins to the defense committee, claiming surveillance and familial strain, an internal investigation by Polish authorities found no evidence corroborating his allegations of mistreatment. They concluded that Bala's narrative was a fabrication. After Bala's separation from his wife in 2000, he displayed possessive behavior towards her, even going as far as to monitor her phone calls. Meanwhile, as Detective Wroblewski and his team investigated a possible motive, they intensified efforts to trace suspicious phone calls made to Janiszewski's office and cell phone on the day he vanished. Utilizing unique card numbers embedded in public phone cards, they traced calls made with the same card, revealing connections to Bala's acquaintances. Another significant lead emerged when a friend of Bala's wife recounted an encounter between her and Janiszewski at a nightclub in 2000. Despite initially meeting casually, the interaction raised suspicions due to Janiszewski's marital status. The investigation then focused on interviewing Bala's ex-wife, Stasia, who had previously refused to cooperate. Showing her passages from Bala's novel, Amok, which depicted striking similarities to their own lives, eventually prompted her to provide crucial information. Stasia revealed an encounter with Janiszewski, during which he admitted his marital status, leading to them parting ways. Subsequently, Bala confronted Stasia violently, accusing her of infidelity and displaying knowledge of her interaction with Janiszewski. Despite her suspicions, Stasia did not initially believe Bala capable of murder, attributing his behavior to jealousy and turmoil in their relationship. This revelation provided Wroblewski with insight into the potential motive behind Janiszewski's murder, as reflected in the closing line of Bala's novel, suggesting a connection between jealousy and the crime. Throughout the trial, Bala observed proceedings from his seat, occasionally questioning the notion of discerning truth. Under Polish law, defendants can directly question witnesses, which Bala eagerly utilized, often framing his inquiries to challenge the stability of their testimony in a Derridean manner. He began scrutinizing the prosecution's evidence, highlighting gaps in their chain of evidence, and emphasizing the lack of eyewitnesses linking him to the crime. Bala argued that the prosecution was constructing a narrative based on random incidents from his life, akin to the plot of a novel. Despite previously subscribing to the idea of the death of the author, Bala protested the prosecution's interpretation of his novel, Amok, asserting his authority as the author, and claiming that the murder depicted in the book was symbolic rather than literal. When the case went to the jury in early September, Bala did not testify, but expressed confidence in the court's decision. Wroblewski, now an inspector, attended the court proceedings, reflecting on the uncertainty of how others perceive the facts. Ultimately, as the judges and jurors returned with the verdict, Bala stood silently as the word guilty was pronounced.
Many men wish death on me, Lord. I don't cry no more. Don't look to the sky no more.